Hello. How's everyone going? Hi. Let's open the chat room so we can see you guys. Hello. Where's everyone signing in from? Hello, hello. Oh, from Hawaii, Seattle, Washington. New Zealand, Chicago. Hello, Finland. Oh, Finland. Oh, how amazing. Hello, hello. Australia,
Melbourne, New South Wales, Michigan, Bali. Hi, Eva.
Hi, Eva. Hello, everyone. Welcome to our very first workshop. My name is Loviisa, and I'm one of the co-founders of Indigo Luna. We're super, super stoked to be offering our first ever workshop. We'll see how today is gonna go, but so stoked to be diving into hormones and the feminine cycle with my beautiful friend Pauline.
Yeah, thank you for having me. It's an honor to be here and to also share my passion with all of you. So yeah, thank you.
Yeah, so stoked. Get comfortable. We're gonna be talking about hormones. The workshop is gonna go more or less for 2 hours. We're not able to hear or see you, but definitely write things on the chat box because that's where we can really connect with all of you. So you can just be on your bed or wherever you feel comfortable and just get comfy. And maybe if you have a pen and some paper, you can take some notes during the workshop. This will also be recorded, and we'll be putting this on YouTube afterwards, so you can then go back and see if you missed anything. But it's really, really super important and interesting topic. So hope you guys will be learning something new today.
So I guess the first question is, and you can all write this in the chat box, is what day of the cycle are you on, or are you taking birth control? And if you are taking birth control, what kind? That way I can know, yeah, where we all are in our cycle. Loviisa and I were both about to bleed and we came wearing the same thing.
Yeah. We didn't plan our matching outfits today, but we both ended up wearing the low set in black.
Ovulating, day 3, Marina.
Getting IUD out
in a week.
Woo! Amazing. I ovulate soon. Oh, wow.
Congratulations, new mama.
Yes.
Cool, amazing.
Mm.
Not gotten back your cycle yet. Amazing. Yeah, this will be huge for you. If you don't have a bleed or you're not ovulating, then this workshop is really going to help you get your bleed back and get your cycle back. Awesome. Well, let's get started.
Yes.
We're going to share a screen, have some slides. That way you can have the most information possible. For your period or on your period, it's going to be a little bit harder to pay attention than if you're about to ovulate. You're going to be in the best time of your cycle to take in new information. Yeah. So
is that good for you as well?
Yep.
Okay, amazing. Thank
you. Okay, so yeah, welcome to hormone cycle awareness. Hormone cycles and hormones, they explain everything. They are basically your blueprint on how to live. And when I talk about woman, for example, throughout the rest of this this webinar, I'm talking about the biological female. So no matter what you identify as, I'm trying to include everyone in terms of that you are, yeah, we're born as a female with this feminine cycle. So yeah. And yeah, let's go on to the next page. So what you're going to learn today is, how and why balancing your hormones, why hormones are so important to understand, and because balancing your hormones are going to balance your life. Then we're going to get into the mind, understanding the thought patterns and how to use your brain efficiently. We're going to get into the emotions as well, understanding that, yeah, throughout the whole four phases of your cycle, you have different emotions and how to understand how to work with them so life flows more easily for you. We're going to go into the physical patterns and in your body and how to work out with your cycle. And then we're going to go into the gut, understanding the digestive patterns and what foods are great to focus on or what nutrients are great to focus on in each phase of your cycle as well. And then finally, we're going to get into fertility and understanding the fertile cycle, the reproductive cycle, understanding that you are only fertile for one day out of your cycle. And so there's no need to take hormonal birth control, for example, throughout the whole, cycle when there's only one day that you are fertile. However, if this is the decision that you want to make, taking hormonal birth control, everyone has the right, as a female, to make that choice of controlling your fertility. So we're going to get into natural ways of understanding or natural ways of your fertility, of controlling your fertility, and knowing that disclaimer, you have the choice of all information of your fertile and your reproductive cycle. Okay, next page. So let's just take a moment. Every time we are going to learn something new, it's really great to take a breath in together. So let's all close down our eyes, fully exhale your breath. And as you breathe in through your nose, inhale deeply. And then out through your mouth. We'll take two more like this. And when you exhale, let out a sigh, a sound. Inhale through the nose. And out through the mouth. One more. Beautiful. Let's slowly open up our eyes. And so you can hear the Balinese ceremonies happening outside. But yeah. What are hormones? Hormones are the chemical messengers between your mind and your body. They are constantly flowing through your bloodstream. And it is the connection between your mind and body. So they affect everything, your brain, your metabolism, your immune system, your gut microbiome, your stress response system, and your sexual reproductive system, as well as your thoughts, your emotions, your feelings, your desires, cravings, literally everything. So this is why it's really important to understand your hormone cycle. And understanding your hormone cycle is hormone cycle awareness. It's having the awareness of basically the question I asked you was, where are you in your cycle? That way you can know, okay, I'm on day 25 of my cycle. I am a little bit more irritable right now. And I can feel that, my bleed is about to come. So I'm just waiting for it. And, I'm going to learn to relax instead of getting more irritated, for example, and just gauging your surroundings based on where you are in your cycle. So this allows you to understand your thoughts, your feelings, your emotions, your desires, and that way you can make better decisions for your mind, for your body, what to eat. And this is so that you can be at your healthiest, because optimal fertility is optimal health. And when you are in this optimal health, you're not having any more PMS symptoms and period pains. So when you balance your hormones, you're getting rid of all of these things that hold you back, and you can focus on your path and your purpose. So the benefits is that when you have balanced hormones, you're getting rid of these symptoms, whether they may be brain fog or digestive issues, hair loss, acne, bloating, cramping, all of these things. They are signs that your body are telling you, hey, pay attention inside now, which is the acronym for pain, pay attention inside now. So it's a reminder that these symptoms are actually a beautiful way to see them as a reminder to pay more attention to yourself and have more self-love, self-care, and to slow down and to, yeah, go inwards. And so when you are balancing your hormones, you're complaining less, and then those around you are in a more positive environment as well. And if you're happier, then your partner's happier and all your relationships are happier. So the more you take care of yourself, the better your surroundings are as well. And as well as benefits, or more benefits of balancing your hormones, is that you're optimizing your fertility. And your fertility, again, this is how nature programmed you, is to reproduce. When you look at nature, like plants, it's going to, they are just trying to be as beautiful, as strong, as healthy as possible, so that that it can reproduce again. And we are nature, you are nature as well. And having this awareness of, okay, I'm going to make myself as fertile as possible, even if I don't want to have children yet or ever, you are optimizing your fertility. And unfortunately, fertility has declined by up to 50% in the last 20 years. So using that fertile energy will become your creation energy. And again, yeah, if you have more self-love, you have more love to give. So hormones, they affect every decision you make. Your, what you want to eat, who you choose as your life partner, your lover, where you want to travel to, your productivity, your wishes, your dreams, everything. And how to balance your hormones, are the top main things are stress management, stress and nutrition. And part of that stress management is moving your body and just having movement constantly flowing energetically as well. And we need to realize that as a woman or biological female, that we do not have the same hormone cycle as a man. Men have a 24-hour hormone cycle. So they're in tune with the sun, and their testosterone is peaking in the morning, and then it goes down by the end of the evening, and it goes up again in the morning. And this is what society is based around, is the 9 to 5. It's the daily do. And there's so much around us that's telling us and giving us that pressure of needing to be productive every single day. However, women, we have a month-long hormone cycle that's in tune with the moon. And you can see this month-long hormone cycle as your inner seasons. So we have menstruation. This is when you bleed. It's also known as your period, your moon time. And this is your inner winter. It's when you want to feel cozy and warm and eat warm foods and just, yeah, coziness. Then in your follicular phase, you're in your inner spring. Once you're done bleeding, you feel more energetic and you feel this growth and you're like, wow, okay, it's springtime, I'm growing. And then you're in ovulation, which is about halfway through your cycle. And this is your inner summer. And your inner summer, you want to be outside. You're probably wearing sexier clothing and you're just wanting to be seen and heard and bloom like a flower. And that's what flowers are doing. They're trying to get the attention to be pollinated. And then you go into the luteal phase, which is your inner autumn or your inner fall. And this is when you're closing down in again. You're becoming more introverted and wanting to get all cozy. So yeah, you can see that you are very much connected to nature. So here is the hormone cycle. It has four phases, although in the ovarian cycle, your egg production, there are two phases. So the moment you start your period, your body is already starting the production of a new egg, which is so amazing. It ends the cycle and then starts the new cycle all over again. So this bleeding time is really the life and rebirth, or death and rebirth moment. And so these are your hormones. The main hormones in your reproductive cycle are estrogen, progesterone, and testosterone. Estrogen is the blue line that you'll see, and it is very low when you're bleeding. And then all the way up until you ovulate, it's rising. And this estrogen is your growth hormone. It is making you more feminine. It is making your face more symmetrical. Your voice is becoming more feminine, more a high-pitched tone to it, the closer you get to ovulation. And it's making your body more curvaceous, your boobs become perkier, your lips become more full. And so it's just making you as feminine as possible so that during ovulation, you are magnetizing your potential mate. And then you have progesterone. And progesterone is the dominating hormone in the luteal phase. And progesterone comes from the word gestation. It's to basically induce the carrying of a child. So as you can see, estrogen was this like, oh, I'm going to find my mate. It's this growth phase making you extroverted. And then progesterone is, oh, I'm potentially pregnant. I'm going to become more introverted and be a little bit more quiet and just surround myself with my closest of friends who would support me in this pregnancy. And it's a very calming hormone, progesterone. So even though you might think, wait, before my period, I don't feel calm, this progesterone is actually helping you to calm you down. And then you have testosterone. So testosterone is the risk-taking, challenge, and confidence hormone. And that's rising around ovulation so that you do go up to find your potential mate and be like, yep, I choose you. So what I like to say is that hormones are the ego. And the ego is this like self-identity, and they're just trying to make you survive and reproduce. And we have these hormonal thoughts and emotions happening all the time, every single day, and thousands and thousands and thousands of them. So you need to basically be aware of which of these thoughts are hormonal. And you have these negative thought patterns or emotions, but they're not really negative. You can see them as a sign to improve yourself. So during menstruation and during your follicular and all the phases, you do have different personalities. And during your menstruation, you tend to feel more vulnerable and sensitive. And then during your follicular or inner spring, since you're preparing yourself for ovulation, you might have these thoughts or feelings of fear, meaning like, your hormones think, what if I don't get pregnant? And what if I don't make money to pay rent? What if I don't do this or finish that? And it's that fear that comes up, because in the follicular phase, your mind is thinking in the future. And so it's doing everything possible and motivating you to get things done and to make things happen and to be productive so that you do ovulate on a hormonal level. But how can you bring this motivation from your reproductive system into, okay, this is the time I'm going to create a business. This is the time I'm going to go out on that date. This is the time I'm going to do this thing or go on that hike that I've always wanted to go on. And then you get into the ovulation phase. And the ovulation phase is when you want all of the attention. And so you might be interrupting more and just grab the attention when maybe it's not your time to shine if you are at somebody else's wedding or birthday party and you're taking all of the attention away. So that's very good to be mindful and modest. And then in your luteal phase, this is really the time when you face your shadows and you do become more emotional and in tune with your inner shadows, which is a beautiful, beautiful thing to face, because this is how you grow. You grow out of darkness. You came from a seed that was in the dark and you left the birth canal and you came into the light, basically. So understanding and facing these inner shadows and this part of your cycle where a lot of women tend to find darkness and not enjoy, going through these emotions and understanding why maybe you're feeling these ways is a great growth period for you. And so some of these feelings or thoughts that can come is that you do naturally have higher levels of stress, because when you have this hormone progesterone that's making you think you're pregnant for the 2 weeks-ish from ovulation until you get your period again, your body is trying to protect you. So it naturally rises your stress levels so that you are more aware of your surroundings and you're driving more slowly, you're cleaning your hands more often. And so the stress is naturally protecting you. And then you can also feel more shame and guilt. This is because in the luteal phase or your inner autumn, you're thinking more in the past. And this is to allow you to make better decisions based on your history. So it's, what did I do well? What did I do wrong? Oh, why did I say this? Why did I say that? And you might feel that shame and guilt because of that. You also might feel more greed because as a potentially pregnant woman, you're like, well, maybe I need more money and I need that water bottle and that's my pillow. And you need to basically have that feeling of safety. And the number one need that you need in the luteal phase is safety. Whether that's in your relationships, you need a partner who's making you feel safe so that you can raise a child in this world with that person. And again, just having the safety of, do I have enough basically to bring a new life into this world? And
just curious to know if anyone has noticed this for, stages in their monthly cycle, because especially after I got more aware of these, I got more aware of myself and that way I noticed some of these in my own life. So curious to know if that resonates to anyone.
Yeah, ever since I came off birth control over a year ago.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and while you guys keep chatting, the last one I'll get into is jealousy. So as a potentially pregnant woman in her luteal phase, and what if your partner goes out, and if your partner is a man, then he produces trillions of sperm per day and he could just go out and impregnate any other woman when you have one egg that you're making over a whole month long. And that's really scary that your man can just go impregnate another woman. And then, so that's why we get naturally feelings of jealousy more often before our period too. Just beginning to track all phases, not just menstruation. And it's so clear. Yeah, it's so good to be aware of all the phases.
Yes.
It's been very empowering to feel these shifts and acknowledge how natural it is. It really is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's life-changing, especially as I relate to my life partner and self.
Mm.
Yeah. I'd not linked fear to follicular phase before, but this month it was very obvious.
Mm.
Yeah, it's so interesting. I mean, even how Loviisa and I showed up today wearing the same outfit and we're both about to bleed.
Yeah.
It's, women can be very predictable and it starts with how we're feeling. And since we're feeling more introverted, wearing darker clothes, we're about to bleed.
Yeah.
So.
For sure.
Mm-hmm. I honestly had no idea about this stuff, and I was never taught anything about my menstrual cycles. It's all very new to me. Same.
Yeah,
like,
me too.
I didn't start learning this stuff until I came off hormonal birth control, and even though I studied 4 years of medicine, like, we never learned about this stuff, and so it's very, very important to get this out. So I'm super grateful for all of you for being here and listening to this and spreading this knowledge.
Because it really is our basic
biological
needs. And it's, we need to know how to, like, we need to know our own self, because that way then we can also explain that to others, and especially for our partners as well, because there's so much beauty in all the shifts that we go through, but we don't have men's 24-hour hormone cycle.
Yeah.
So it's very different. Both are beautiful in their own ways, but there needs to be awareness in both.
Yeah, for sure. Great. Well, let's keep going. Thank you, everyone. I agree. It's very empowering. Okay. And I'll get to that. Yeah, we'll get to questions in the end as well. So keep note of your questions.
Yeah, keep chatting.
Cool.
Yes, keep chatting.
Okay, so then we have these common positive patterns. And so you can change the energy from the darkness into the light. So if you are having fear, this also is from the same hormone of dopamine, and dopamine is the motivation hormone. So if you can take that fear of maybe I'm not going to pay rent this month, or, you know, then take that as a motivation of I'm going to create something. I'm going to follow my dreams and follow my heart, because the more you do follow your heart, things come towards you and things start happening. And so when you're using, again, these negative, quote unquote, negative, and turning them into a positive thing, you get so much growth out of it. So during menstruation, you tend to be very in the present. Whereas I mentioned before, in the follicular phase, you tend to think more in the future. And in the luteal phase, you tend to think more in the past. When you're bleeding, I could say that we're very like, yes, I'm bleeding right now. Like, you're very in the present. You are more vulnerable and sensitive, which was also mentioned in the negative patterns part. But it, again, depends on how you use that vulnerability and sensitivity. Can you allow yourself to be vulnerable and open? And in Native American tribes and many other ancient tribes as well, is they use and say that the menstruation phase is when a woman is most psychically and spiritually in tune and connected to source. So this bleeding time is such a powerful and beautiful time to reconnect with your womb, to reconnect with, yeah, why you're here, what your purpose is, and just being. We're human beings, not human doings. And so allowing this time to just be is very beautiful, and to allow yourself to surrender and to be vulnerable. It's a great time to allow yourself to receive and for self-love as well. And then we get into the follicular phase. So as I mentioned before, this is the future mindset time of your cycle. As you're preparing for ovulation, yeah, your hormones are like, how do I become as pretty, smart, strong, amazing as possible so that you are at your peak during ovulation? And so this is a great time to be mind mapping, planning ahead, setting goals, socializing, learning something new, being extroverted, and it's a time when you are more positive and more giving in your cycle as well. And then when you're in ovulation, again, you're very much in the present. You're like, yes, everyone, look at me, pay attention to me. I am here. I am the most important one. And so this is ovulation. Ovulation is only one day. It's literally a moment in time. But you can feel the ovulation high for about 3 to 4 days. And as I'm speaking about the number of days in each phase, it can be different for everyone. But the average, let's say, menstruation is 3 to 6 days. Follicular phase is about 10 days long. And then ovulation is technically one day, but you can feel the high for 3 to 4 days. And then the luteal phase is about 2 weeks. So again, you don't necessarily need to have a 28, 29 day cycle. But I do believe there is such a beauty to becoming as close to nature as possible with the moon cycle. And it's a good guide to use the moon as, finding that inner nature and finding that connection to nature. So then in ovulation, being seen, being heard, using this time to maybe do a photo shoot or record something, sing, and using your voice, because it is most articulate and feminine during this time. It's the best time to ask for promotion. Again, this is the time when you're most magnetic, and so you can ask for what you want, and you have a better chance at getting what you want during this time. And to also present your work. If you are going to, let's say you have a product, this is the best time to sell it and things like that. And then finally, in the luteal phase, this is when you think in the past. And it's also when you are focusing more on the feminine side of activities. So you're more creative, artistic. Literally, both hemispheres of your brain are communicating with each other the most. And it's allowing you to think outside the box and to yeah, be super creative. And it's also when you're most intuitive, because your hormones think you're pregnant. So you're not only thinking for yourself, but your potential baby as well. So you're having that bigger gut feeling and better intuition to make more important decisions. You are more aware, you're more reflective, and your brain loves to focus on details and like make your home like all cozy and nesting and organizing. This is the time to do it. And so within the hormone cycle, your energy levels change as well, and your mindset. So when you're on your period, you can see all of your hormones are the lowest. This means your energy is the lowest. You're literally losing blood that was about to create life. So this is a time to rest. And also just having a bunch of other people's thoughts is maybe not to your capacity. So having that cave time and honoring your moon time to be more alone and to be more introverted is really great when your energy levels are low. But then when you are going closer to ovulation during the follicular phase, you're becoming more and more positive and more giving and more this outward energy. Whereas then when you're ovulating, you're like, this is the best day in the world. Has that happened to any of you when you're ovulating? You're like, this is the best day ever. I'm so beautiful. Yes. Yeah, the ovulation glow. And I love it. Some people come up and they're like, wow, you're glowing. What are you using? And you're like, well, I'm ovulating.
It's very true. Like sometimes you just get this plovulating from that. And sometimes you just get random people like approach you more. Like I'm very introverted. And I just noticed that, especially in my luteal phase, I can be very like even more introverted. But then like there's this time in my cycle when I am ovulating that I just feel a bit more like out there and extroverted. And I might get random people approach me on the street or something, which is rare because usually I'm so introverted. So it's a very interesting and beautiful feeling.
Yeah.
By the way, when you are typing on the chat, just make sure that you click the little blue dot to everyone, so everyone can see your messages, because there's a lot coming in that only we can see, because there's some really beautiful messages coming through. So it's amazing to connect. Yeah.
And then so the last phase, the luteal phase, is when again you are going more into that introversion like you were talking about, and you're maybe not as like positive, whereas like literally when you're ovulating you feel that energy of abundance and you're like, I'll pay for everyone, I'll do and you feel like you have so much to give. Whereas when you're in the luteal phase, then you tend to be again a little bit more greedy.
I feel cool.
And you want to cuddle up more with doggies and so then something that's really, really important, so please take note right now for this, is the transition between ovulation and the luteal phase. This is called the post-ovulation estrogen drop, and it is very important to be aware of, because from that day that you're like, wow, best day ever, this is amazing, I feel so good, and then the next day when you stop ovulating, you enter the luteal phase, and estrogen takes a drop. And estrogen and serotonin, your happiness hormone, are interlinked, they're connected. So you go from ovulation of like, I'm so happy, best day ever, to, oh, what's wrong with me? I was so happy yesterday, and then today I'm not feeling good. I have mood swings and all this. And you're just going through this rumination of what's wrong with me? Why? Yeah. Like what I just said. But it's super important to know that you do have a drop of energy and mood for about 2 to 3 days after ovulation. And to not get so attached to it. Again, this is your ego self. Your hormone cycle is your ego. We want to learn to partner with it and to take care of the ego, because this is the character that we have been given in this life to play. But know that you can make higher self decisions. So maybe you're not ready to have a family right now, but you can use that energy from family creation or procreation into your dreams and your passions and your purpose. So, yeah. And then with birth control, again, like, it's completely your decision to manage your reproductive cycle. I just want, because this is something I went through, and this is what the reason why I am teaching what I'm teaching today is because of my birth control journey. And so hormonal birth control, when I went to the doctor and I had really bad cramps and my periods were 2 weeks long and it was just a really terrible time, I went to the doctor and the doctor didn't tell me about the hormone cycle. He said, here, just take a pill. You don't need a period. It's for old time's sake. And so 10 years of being on the pill, I felt disconnected from my body. And then finally, when I came off hormonal birth control, I went through a year of depression and lost half my hair. And so I just want to make this aware for all of you that that hormonal birth control, it does not fix or regulate your period. And I want to empower you with the knowledge of what hormonal birth control does and what it is like to not feel the symptoms that maybe you were covering up with, or that maybe your doctor said, like, here, you can get rid of acne by taking hormonal birth control, but you can also get rid of acne naturally. So again, I just want to bring the awareness of what hormonal birth control can do, but you do have the decision and the informed decision to continue with hormonal birth control or to follow your natural cycle. And so some things that it does is that it disconnects your brain from your ovaries because it won't make your natural estrogen anymore. It depletes your gut microbiome so that you're not able to absorb nutrients as well. It gets rid of your stress response system so that that signaling system back up to your brain doesn't exist anymore. And that signaling is very important to be able to get rid of that stress. So when you're on hormonal birth control, you hold on to a lot more stress in your body. And it basically just suppresses everything so that you are in a way too unhealthy to give birth. So it does work as birth control, but I do feel that you can do this using natural methods of fertility awareness. So here are some natural ways of tracking your fertility. They're called FAM, FAMs, fertility awareness methods. And the more methods you use, the better success rate you have with preventing or planning pregnancy. And so just remember that you are just like the earth. And when you're dry, so you might have noticed that your cervical mucus is different throughout the cycle. Sometimes you're bleeding. And then when you're in the follicular phase, your cervical mucus will be creamy white. And then when you're ovulating, you'll see a clear, like, raw egg white. And you'll even feel your libido, your sex drive is back. And you're like, oh, like, it's time to procreate. And then, so that's when you're feeling wet. And then when you're dry again, when you're infertile in the luteal phase, your cervical mucus or discharge will be creamy white again. So it's very normal to have these differences in cervical mucus. So again, yeah, it changes throughout the cycle, and your cervix will also change throughout the cycle as well. So you, in this next photo, here's your reproductive anatomy. You have your vagina, which is, so the whole womb space and the outside that you can see is called the vulva. But once you go inside, this is the vagina, that's the vaginal canal. And then at the top of the vaginal canal, you have the cervix. And the cervix will move up and down throughout your cycle. So this is a way for you to be aware of, am I fertile or not? So everyone take your finger and put your finger on your lips. And you can feel it soft, it's a little bit open, okay? And then put your finger on your nose. It's a little bit harder, right? And firm, and yeah. So your cervix will feel like this throughout the different phases of your cycle. When, as you can see in the uterus, the uterus, the triangular shape. This is where you are creating the endometrial lining, which is what then becomes your menstrual blood. This is what you're shedding. So your cervix will need to open to let the blood out. And you'll notice as well that your cervix will be at the lowest. So let's say you're making love and you can feel that it's more sensitive because your cervix is much lower. And so whatever is going inside that's healthy and safe is touching it more closely, the cervix. And then it will close back up again. So, okay. So when you're menstruating, it's open. So it feels like your lips. So when you're bleeding, it feels like your lips, your cervix is open to let the blood out. But then once you're done bleeding, the cervix will start moving up and up towards ovulation. And during that center, the follicular phase, it'll be hard and closed like your nose. So this is how you can basically see if you are fertile or not, is because when the cervix is closed, like your nose, the tip of your nose, then sperm cannot go inside into your uterus and get you pregnant. But then when you're ovulating, your cervix is the highest, and then it will be open like your lips again. And you can feel that with your fingers. Make sure that your nails are nicely trimmed and clean, and so you can feel this every single day, but you'll notice that your cervix will be open and soft during ovulation, and that's to let sperm in. So you are fertile for only one day, and it's when you are ovulating. However, sperm can live inside of you for up to 5 days. So you have this window of about a week to be safe, a week to 10 days, let's say, that you use a condom or withdrawal or a different form of natural birth control so that you don't fall pregnant if that's your plan. However, if you do want to get pregnant in the week before you ovulate, this is a good time to make love. And so, yeah, your cervix will change throughout the cycle, and in the luteal phase, you will be infertile again and it will feel like the tip of your nose. And with the cervical mucus, when it's creamy white, it's a sign of non-fertility or you're not fertile. But then when it's creamy white, the closer you get to ovulation, sorry, not creamy white, clear, like raw egg white, it will mean that you are in your fertile phase. So you can also do, actually go back one again. You can also do the temperature method. And so the temperature method is when you take a basal thermometer, and you put it under your tongue every morning, or you can get the Aura ring. And I know that there's the Natural Cycles app is a great one to use. And that is, you take your temperature every morning and before you get out of bed, because this is your basal temperature. It's the lowest your temperature will be at. And basically the moment you get your period up until ovulation, your temperature is the lowest. But then once baby's in the oven, potentially, your temperature rises, and from ovulation until you bleed again, your temperature will be high. So this is another way of tracking your fertility. And it's really important to track not only your bleed, and the first day of your bleed is the first day of your cycle, and also the day of ovulation, when you feel that super abundant feeling and you see this like raw egg white coming out of your vagina as well. So these are a few different ways. If you want to look more deeply into natural fertility awareness methods, you can write me on Instagram or do some of your own research on the internet. There's plenty of information on fertility awareness methods. And the more you use, the better chance you have as well. So as you saw, like your cervical positioning will change and the rest of your body changes as well, your physical body. Everything changes throughout the four phases of your cycle. And in your menstruation, you'll basically feel like, the lower energy. And how you work out would be very different than how you would work out when you do have that super high energy during ovulation. So the benefits of moving your body with your cycle is that it improves your digestion. It stimulates your vagus nerve. Your vagus nerve is the one of the biggest nerves from your brain into your body. And it activates your parasympathetic nervous system, which is your rest and digest nervous system. And so moving your body is allowing you to relax more. It reduces bloating, cramping, anxiety, stress, acne, brain fog, mood swings. It raises your energy, balances your weight. It makes you calm and focused and increases happiness and motivation. Motivation is dopamine, happiness, serotonin. And throughout the four phases, so I have a little graph here on what you can do. When you are bleeding, again, your energy is the lowest. You're bleeding. And this is the time to be very gentle and loving with your body. So doing some gentle stretches and really focusing on your hip openers, like this womb space is really good to focus on during your menstruation. And you want to restore the energy that you are losing. However, once you enter the follicular phase or your inner spring, then again, you're entering that growth phase. And this is the time when estrogen is rising, and estrogen is a growth hormone. It's making your bones stronger. It's making your brain smarter. It's making your muscle gaining and recovery quicker. So this is the time to add the intensity. The closer you get to ovulation, you add more and more intensity of your workouts. So this is the time to do high intensity, cardio, to add more weights incrementally. And this is the time that your body is using your stored fat as fuel, and your body and face become more symmetrical. And then in ovulation, this is when your estrogen is peaking and testosterone. And however, it's really important though that you know that during ovulation and peaking estrogen is a hormone that can make you swell. So it's making your lips swell, it's making your boobs swell, and it has that effect basically. So it makes your joints swell up as well. So it's really important to work out during the follicular phase because you're working on your muscles. But then during ovulation, you really want to focus on muscle engagement. So let's say I have an arm like this and my elbow is just really like not protected at all. But then once I flex my arm and I'm engaging my muscles, can't see my bicep, but you can see that I'm protecting my joint, my elbow, when I am engaging my muscles. So you want to do that with all of your body. You want to engage your muscles during ovulation so that you protect your joints, because women, we have like 8 times more risk of knee injuries than men do. And that's because of the ovulation phase that we have. This is when we're the least flexible. So yeah, I wouldn't get into some super cross-legged twisty pose during this time, again, for protecting your joints. And it is when your face and body are most quote unquote beautiful and symmetrical. You are beautiful. And this is very important to know that you are beautiful and the same beautiful, amazing human throughout all four phases of your cycle. But this is just when you have the most confidence during ovulation. And then in the luteal phase is, again, when you're feeling more introverted and your stress levels naturally rise because your hormones think you're pregnant. So tuning back in and slowing down and doing more gentle movements, not doing the high intensity like you were in the follicular leading up to ovulation, but learning to tune into more of the feminine side of being more flexible and more into the dance, into the moving your hips. And yeah, so you, this time in your body is when you're using food as fuel, whereas in the follicular phase, you were using stored fat as fuel. So definitely need to eat during this phase. We'll get into the food later. But yeah, you don't want to over-exercise or add more stress, because you already have higher levels of stress during this time, during this phase, and you want to lower that stress. If you add more stress, so that's mental stress, emotional stress, physical stress. So if you're over-exercising during this time, you're actually turning on fat storage, muscle wasting, and bone density loss. So it's really important to honor the slowing down during the luteal phase. And so you want to focus more on low intensity cardio and weights, going on a nature walk, and doing things that relax you. So then I also created OmCycle Yoga, which is ovulation menstruation cycle yoga. And your hormone glands, which are in all over your body, but through the center, you'll have your pineal gland, your third eye, is your pituitary gland, your hypothalamus, and your thyroid, your thyroid. Oh my gosh, I'm right before my period. And your thymus is your immune boosting, like it produces the white blood cells. Then you have your pancreas, your liver, your kidneys, the adrenals that are above the kidneys, and then you have your ovaries. And so all of these different hormone glands, they are actually your chakras. So you have Indian philosophy of the chakra system, and then you have Western philosophy of the hormone glands. And when you put them together, they're in the same spots. So really, they're just two different doors to the same thing. And so in OmCycle Yoga, I am connecting the science to the spiritual of focusing on a certain chakra or a certain hormone gland in each of the different phases of your cycle. Doing yin during your bleed, doing vinyasa in the follicular phase, and more grounding vinyasa during ovulation or hatha yoga. And then you can do more flowy, gentle vinyasa during your luteal phase. So yeah, and then we go into, well, first one question, do any of you follow your cycle with how you work out? And can you feel the different energy levels? Like some days maybe you don't want to go to the gym, or you just feel, do any of you feel that?
Yes, for sure.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yes.
And starting to, and it feels so much better and enjoying.
Yes, but trying to be more mindful and kind to myself in those moments than pushing through.
Yeah.
That is the biggest thing, because really, at least from my own experience as well, like I used to go to the gym or exercise or however that movement was for me at that stage of my life. I thought I have to do it every day, and now it's more tuning into different forms of exercise or different practice or whatever that might be according to that cycle. Mm-hmm. And there is so much, it feels so much more true, and there's so much less forcing. There's so much more listening to the body because it is so wise.
Yeah. And again, it comes from that, the society we live in of like, you have to work out every single day, you have to lose weight, you have to do this and that, and it's like, whoa, hold on,
yeah,
I don't function like that. And so it's really tuning in back into your feminine nature of slowing down and honoring your cycle. Yeah, the biggest change I've made is slowing down during my bleed. It changes everything. It really sets you up for the rest of your cycle. You have so much more energy for the whole rest of your cycle when you can slow down during your bleed, for sure. Amazing. Thank you, everyone. I had to teach power yoga almost every day throughout luteal and period, and it really took a toll on my body. So this is really... if you are a yoga teacher and you do have to teach, let's say, Ashtanga or power yoga, and you're bleeding, you are the teacher, and you don't necessarily need to do all the poses. So you can say like, hey, I'm on my period and I'm going to recite everything that you will all do. But yeah, that's a really good tip, is to be honoring your cycle as well as being present holding the space that you are.
Feminine nature and honoring cycle.
Amazing.
Yeah. Thank you, everyone. It's good to hear from you. So we'll get into the digestive system. metabolism. So your digestion is basically how your body is digesting food and taking in the nutrients. So first, and this is a really important thing that's not in the slide, so I want you to take note. The first step of digestion is your saliva. Hippocrates said, chew your drinks and drink your foods. Basically, chew your foods 20 to 30 times until it becomes soup in your mouth, and you're getting all of that saliva, all of the enzymes that will break down the food so that you can then better digest your food. And then whatever you're drinking, also just leave it in your mouth for a bit, like savor it, taste it, and just have it, you know, swish it around and before swallowing it again, because you are getting the enzymes that your mouth is producing to start the first step of digestion and to tell your brain, oh, I'm starting eating now. And again, we live in a society where it's like, oh, we need to work and we need to get this timeline done and I need to eat quickly and then go back to work. And it's just, this is so important to balancing your hormones, is to just take a breath and to relax while you're eating. You cannot digest your food well if you are stressed. You cannot absorb your nutrients if you are stressed. Again, you are putting yourself more in a fight or flight mode, and when you want to be in the rest and digest mode while you are eating. So you are getting so much more benefits from your food, from your nutrients, when you are taking the time to be present with what you are eating and, yeah, the environment that you're in. So that's digestion. It's the whole digestive process. And then you have metabolism, and that's the rate at which you digest food. It's your hunger levels. And your metabolism and your digestion will change throughout the cycle. So you might have noticed that you tend to be hungrier before your period. And then the moment you get your period, that hunger goes away. And the closer you get to ovulation, you're less hungry. You're the least hungry during ovulation. And this is because your hormones are making you think like, okay, find my mate. And I don't need to, like, I can't get distracted by food right now. Just focus on finding a mate. Whereas in the luteal phase, then your mind is thinking, where's my food? I'm hungry now, feed me. You wake up and you're more hungry, and you actually need 200 to 300 more calories in your luteal phase because you are potentially pregnant. And again, you're getting your fuel, your energy from food during this phase. So don't deprive yourself of nutrients during the luteal phase. This is really important. Again, it kind of does it that same thing as the work over working out. It depletes your gut absorption, and it turns on fat storage, and it just doesn't make your body function as optimally when you are not eating enough during the luteal phase, especially. So it's really important to know this. And so the follicular phase is your gut healing phase. And so we really want to focus on, well, we'll get into that in the next, we can go to the next slide. So how to eat for your cycle. Basically, when you're menstruating, you're in your inner winter and you want to focus on nutrient dense, warm cooked foods during this time. And this is a time to eat a steak, red meat or broccoli, dark leafy greens, and cacao. These all have iron, magnesium, and zinc. This is what you're losing from your blood. So you want to restore your nutrients with iron, magnesium, and zinc rich foods. Wherever you are in the world, look up local seasonal foods that are in my area with iron and or iron rich foods. And then you can see which ones are more available to you, to your food choices, your diet, and things like that. So I just gave some examples, but, you know, do what feels best for you that are rich in iron, magnesium, and zinc. And then in the follicular phase, you can have more of this like Mediterranean style diet of you're in that inner spring. And so you're having more lightly sauteed vegetables and fish, foods that are rich in omega-3s, because this is when your egg is maturing inside the follicle in preparation for ovulation. So you want to eat omega-3s to help the maturation of the egg. And then fermented foods, because this is your gut healing phase. And fermented foods are really good to have. They have a lot of probiotics and prebiotics. What I do every morning is I have like a tiny, like a few drops of apple cider vinegar in a glass of water, and that has prebiotics and it helps build the good gut bacteria to absorb nutrients better and digest food better. And then in ovulation, we have, you're the least hungry. So you can think of like the light summer foods. This is when you can, your body can handle raw vegan foods, let's say, more easily. Otherwise, I would recommend eating as like cooked foods as possible throughout your cycle. It will really help balance your hormones. But during ovulation, everything is just working at its best during this time. So having raw is more easily digestible during this time. Having broccoli and other foods in that family, like cauliflower, Brussels sprouts, kale, those are all really good because they help detox any excess estrogen. And what that means is that sometimes you can make too much estrogen. We have so many even fake estrogens around, and that's synthetic materials. So it's really good to wear Indigo Luna because they're natural and don't affect your hormones. This is why I love them. And so even cleaning products and what you're using as dish soap or even shampoo and soaps, and just minimizing the synthetics and connecting more with natural products are going to make your hormones feel a lot better. And so having too many of these xenoestrogens or outside source estrogens are going to put more in your body and make you feel more symptoms. And so by eating foods like broccoli and kale and even cabbage, those are gonna help reduce and flush out that excess estrogen. And also a big topic is the phytoestrogens. And those are like soy. You've probably heard, is it good for you? Is it bad for you? And when I'm talking about food, I'm always wanting you to choose as natural whole foods as possible, organic and non-genetically modified. Again, because it's your body thrives on nature, and so you will feel better with natural foods. But soy is a phytoestrogen, as well as beans and seeds. So these basically are a weaker form of estrogen, and this is your estrogen receptor, and your estrogen goes in and it makes you beautiful and happy and all the things. But then you eat soy and it goes into the same receptor, and then your natural estrogen can't get in. So when you have a lot of estrogen during ovulation, and maybe sometimes you might feel irritable during ovulation, you have like too much energy. And so this might be a sign that you have too much estrogen. And so eating foods like even hummus and other beans and soy and things like that are going to help you detox excess estrogen. So whereas for men, if they eat a lot of soy, they tend to have, it adds estrogen into their bodies, whereas for women, it takes away estrogen. So again, depending on where you are in your cycle, it's better to have phytoestrogens around ovulation, and maybe not so much during your bleed, because you want your own natural estrogen to give you that natural rise in energy. And then in the luteal phase, I like to have Indian food. Like you have the warming spices, the curry, the coconut milk. And so in the luteal phase, you want to focus on slow burning carbs, which are like pumpkin, sweet potato, carrots, root vegetables, versus like a piece of cake, for example. It's going to spike your blood sugar levels and then make you crash, and you're going to have like your blood sugar is really important to take care of and to keep stabilized. So again, having non-packaged processed foods that are going to spike your blood sugar levels and make you have mood swings and other symptoms. Whereas if you eat natural whole foods that have a good blood sugar balance to it, you're going to feel so much better. And your hormones are made out of fats. So it's really important to eat fats and healthy fats. like avocado, olive oil. If you're cooking with it, I would recommend olive oil or ghee, which is a clarified butter. So having those healthy forms of fats are going to make healthy hormones. And yeah, so it's,
what phase did you say eating phytoestrogen is good?
In the ovulation phase, yes.
And grains, so we can get into these questions maybe, Okay. Grains, so there are different types of grains throughout the whole cycle as well. And it depends on what your body can handle. So for me, for example, in your luteal phase, your digestion slows down so that it has a longer transit time to absorb nutrients. But for me, like in the luteal phase, I can't do rice. I'm just like, no, rice plugs me up. So I'm not going to eat rice during, it's going to slow down my digestion even more. Whereas in the, like when I menstruate, all of a sudden your digestion, maybe some of you and me included in the past, not me more, but used to get the period poops and I would poop, like have diarrhea 5 times a day. And it was just like, whoa, everything's flowing out. If anyone else wants to. So, you know, it depends. Really, the whole food topic is so complex. But this is a general, like, focus on healthy fats and slow burning carbs and having some phytoestrogens during ovulation and nutrient dense foods during rich in iron, magnesium and zinc during menstruation. And in your follicular phase, focus on fermented foods and omega-3s.
Someone asked, what do I do about sugar cravings? Mm-hmm. Am I lacking in something if I crave it?
So sugar cravings are basically going to be a sign of insulin or blood sugar imbalance. So it depends, like, are you eating slow sugars? You know, there are different kinds of sugars. If you eat a candy, that's going to make you crave more candy because it gives you energy and then makes you spike. And then you're like, well, I need that energy again. So I'm going to crave sugar again. Mm-hmm. So having, let's say, better forms of sugar are fruits, and having one fruit away from other meals is really good. So that way you keep, again, your blood sugar stabilized. So let's say you have breakfast, and I like having eggs and vegetables and like sweet potato, and then an avocado. And then in between breakfast and lunch, especially in my luteal phase, because I'm going to want to eat more during this time, I have a fruit. And then 2 hours later, then I have my lunch. And then 2 hours later, I have another fruit, and then I have dinner. So having like a stabilized blood sugar that way is not going to make me crave sugar. Or you? What do you
think? I used to have a big problem, but like really unbalanced blood sugar. And something I've done in the last 6 months especially is I'm taking a tablespoon of apple cider vinegar before meals.
Yep.
That has helped me a lot. Especially if I'm having carbs in the meal, and then always starting with the savory breakfast. And then I can have, and if you have a dessert, or if I have a dessert, I would have that after a savory meal. And then something amazing also is to go for a 10-minute walk after eating, because then the energy that you're putting into your body and the insulin response, your muscles are going to start using it rather than it going into stored fat. So that's something that I've personally done in the last couple of months, and it has worked really well for me.
So amazing how all of those PMS and period pains can be avoided. I can't wait to incorporate this. For sure. And yes, cinnamon. Kimmy, you mentioned cinnamon helps balance cravings. Yeah, so cinnamon is a great one, adding into like the warming spices in the luteal phase when you do tend to crave more sugar. Cinnamon is a blood sugar balancer. So having cinnamon, and just think about like autumn foods, like, oh, I want that pumpkin spice, cinnamon, like kind of giddy thing.
For sure. Yes, love the walks after a meal for digestion and movement. For sure, that can really help.
Yeah. And you'll see, like, you'll notice already by next cycle, you're going to have so many reduced symptoms and feel so much better, and you're going to have less cravings and things like that. If you start eating more naturally and eating for your cycle, like all of your problems go away and you're like, why did I never do this before?
Yeah. Was there something about cacao that you've mentioned also before?
Mm-hmm. So cacao is the raw form of chocolate, right? And we tend to crave chocolate before our periods and on our periods. And that's because cacao is really rich in magnesium. And magnesium is a muscle relaxer, and it helps you sleep better. And so cacao, although I wouldn't eat or drink cacao or eat cacao right before going to bed because it has theobromine, which is kind of like caffeine, so it excites you. It's an aphrodisiac. But it does have that high form of magnesium. So your body craves chocolate before and on your period because it wants to have that relaxed feeling and the heart opener. And so you can also crave foods that are that your body feels it's lacking. Yeah.
Did that answer?
Yeah. I just thought that was a fascinating detail because I always crave chocolate and cacao before and during my period.
Yeah. And so, yeah, when you do go for chocolate, like, just make sure that it's a dark chocolate, like it says cacao on it, not cocoa, because cocoa means that it's been processed. So you just want to make sure that it says cacao, because that's where it has the full medicinal benefits of chocolate. And when you just have a little bite of dark chocolate, you're satisfied. I mean, some of you might say like, oh, I'll just eat a whole bar, but the darker it is, the more pure it is, you're satisfied with just a bite instead of eating a whole bar that has the processed sugar in it that just makes you want to eat more and more and more.
Sure.
Yeah. So, and then is there anything we'd love to share about medicinal mushrooms, how they support us, especially turkey tail? Yeah, medicinal mushrooms are one of my favorite things as well. They are adaptogens, and adaptogens are basically medicinal plants that are going to help you balance, and they read your body, what your body needs. So, for example, reishi, it goes straight to your kidneys, it lower in your adrenals, it lowers your stress, it helps you calm down. And if any of you have ever had a urinary tract infection, reishi will cure it like right away, or treat it right away. So reishi mushroom is really good. I prefer using tinctures versus the powder because tincture goes directly into your bloodstream, whereas a powder will go into your digestive system, and it depends on how well your digestive system is. The other ones, chaga, turkey tail, and turkey tails is really good because it's really good for women. It helps treat women with breast cancer, and these medicinal mushrooms can really reduce tumors, and highly recommend. And the thing with adaptogens and even ones like ashwagandha or rhodiola, you want to have them in the afternoon because you have a spike in cortisol or stress level in the morning, and that's to help you wake up and do things in the day. So it's really good to have that stress spike or cortisol spike in the morning. But then you can have like the medicinal mushroom or another form of adaptogen in the afternoon, because if you continue to be stressed, let's say from work or emotional or whatever it may be, then it will help you relax back down and sleep better and kind of train your body to have this new way of more relaxed cycle.
I also find for me that if I eat breakfast ideally 30 minutes to 1 hour after waking up, that has really helped my stress levels because of that cortisol that you were saying.
Yep.
If it gets too high, then I will stay in this fight or flight mode more or less throughout the whole day, which obviously I don't want to operate from that place.
Mm-hmm.
So making sure that I eat breakfast, it is super, super important for women. And especially now, because there's been a lot of talk about intermittent fasting and all this, and a lot of those studies have been done on men, like most studies, but actually for females, it is so much more beneficial for us to actually have breakfast especially within the first hour after waking up.
Yeah.
For our ideal hormones.
Yeah, for sure. And yeah, thank you for bringing that up. It's really important for women to eat. Like, it's our bodies are constantly in creation mode and wanting to create. And so, yeah, again, like you said, like, most research has been done on men. So all of these diet fads and intermittent fasting and things like that, that was done for men, but it's not ideal for women. If you do want to do a cleanse or a fast or detox, the best time to do it is when you are less hungry and when you are in that gut healing phase of the follicular intovulation. Definitely don't do it in the luteal phase. Like, your body needs nutrients. It needs 200 to 300 more calories during this time. And if you deprive yourself of nutrients during your luteal phase or any other phase, really, your body's just like, what are you doing? I'm potentially pregnant. Like, I need food. So you act from a stressful place of survival mode. Again, it's that hormonal self and not your, okay, I've eaten my breakfast. I've taken care of my hormonal self. Now I can make the best decision for my business, for my family, for myself.
Yeah. Show up with an open heart for the best of everyone.
Yeah. And this last question I really want to get into. I feel like finances can really hold me back from having the healthiest lifestyle. I want to obtain all natural products, but yeah, they cost more than synthetics, and eating whole foods all the time can be difficult to manage time-wise. I stress myself out a lot with this and try to do as much as I can with what I have, but I still find that I struggle with it. Yeah, the best thing is to try the best you can. And that's, I find, like, a really sad thing as well, that the government subsidized the kind of unhealthy foods, the packaged foods, so that it just makes just more unhealthy people. And then we go to the doctor more, and then it's just that. Just think that what you're doing for yourself now, you are giving yourself more energy when you are choosing more natural products. And you are creating that better lifestyle for yourself. And then that will create the better lifestyle and your surroundings and your business and your whatever you put your energy towards. When you fill up your own cup with what you do want to fill up with, then you are giving from that place. And you can, you can make little things better and better, I think. Make little improvements and just try to go for the lowest hanging fruit, whatever is easiest for you. And I don't expect any of you to be perfect in doing every single thing that I did today or that I mentioned about, but just choose the things that are easiest for you to make a difference. And you'll see that making those little steps, step by step, is going to help a lot.
Yeah. And I just want to say, like, obviously choose what feels good for you, because then the stress that you can feel about not using all natural products can actually cause you more harm than actually, like, you need to find the balance that works for you the best, because that is, it's such a big theme in our human life, is balance with everything. So it's also the balance with choosing what you have available and what resources you have for things. So it's not, like, so black and white with things, and we don't always have to, we can just do what's, like, what's best and what you have the capacity for. So also don't feel shame or bad about not being able to be perfect. That is also such a thing with women, especially, like, females. So I feel like just have grace for yourself as well, and just do and choose the best that you have available right now, and then just little steps where you can towards the kind of life that you wanna live.
Yeah, for sure. And and you can also try to see what things can be used as a multi-use. For example, I use apple cider vinegar for my gut, but I also use it for my conditioner. So there are some products that you can use that are like, oh, I can, and I also clean, like, my whiteboard with vinegar. So it's, there are some products that are so simple, and it's what our grandmothers used, you know, in our ancestors, they used these very simple products until businesses got created, and it's like, oh, now we need something for this and that, and it's so specific. But yeah, baking soda used for my dishes it's natural and it cleans and
it's a lot about going back into our grandma's wisdom.
Yeah,
I feel like there's so much wisdom in there that we can incorporate into our really fast-paced lifestyle right now.
Yeah.
Like if you have your grandma alive, like, or your mom, really go back into that wisdom and maybe ask them how things were then, because obviously it has all changed so much in the last 100 years or so.
Yeah. Like our grandmothers probably didn't have pads. Like they probably used reusable underwear, period underwear, or, you know, so think as well, like, how can I reduce my costs? I make like an initial investment in period underwear, for example, but then I don't need to buy pads and tampons for, you know, 10 years. So in the end, you do save money. Same with a cup. And so using period products, like that's really important, that are natural, because if you're putting tampons that are the generic ones, at least, those are dipped in bleach. And then if you're putting bleach and other toxic chemicals inside of you, that can literally, like, it has killed some women, but it can make you so sick. There's toxic shock syndrome, and you're putting toxic chemicals in your womb space. So it's really important to use natural period products, at least. And if you can start with one, I would say be that. And yeah, and just the lowest hanging fruit again, but.
Someone said you can make apple cider vinegar at home with apple scraps and water. That's so awesome. Yeah. I absolutely love that.
Mm-hmm.
And Eva said apple cider also great as face toner and mixed with water, great home remedy for pimples or breakout.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or if you have a mosquito bite or, you know, like.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's always internet search of natural ways to do whatever. And then it gives you so many things. And balancing pH, yeah, no, it's really good. I've heard about tampons and cups being bad for you to put in your vagina as it stops the flow properly. So it depends how you feel about it. I used a cup for a really long time and I loved it. And I still do feel the flow, you know, being dropped into a cup, and I'm using then that cup, and I can take out the cup and I see the color and the consistency of the blood. And I'm like, wow, okay, it's healthy. Oh, there's a little bit more. If it's more purple, then it means I was too cold and there's some stagnation and energy. And so I'm going to move my body more this next cycle. So I really feel like the cup is a educational way. And again, I've had it for like 10 years, the cup. And, you know, so it's really good for the environment. And then I recently switched to using period underwear. But I do miss the like holding up the cup, and then I would put my, might be weird for some of you, but your menstrual blood is super sacred, and you can use it as an amazing face mask because it has stem cells in it. And stem cells, people get injected with stem cells. They pay thousands of dollars, and us women, we make this amazing medicine every single month. So you can put it on your scars and it will heal your skin, your scars more quickly. You can put it on your face, you let it until it dries, like a clay mask. Again, you don't need to buy a clay mask product. You can just use your own medicine and use that. Or you can even use it and put it on your plants and return it to nature, and you see your plants will bloom, like they love it. So
whatever you feel comfortable with. And also, I've also used both the cup and period underwear. I just switch sort of between periods and what I'm doing and how I'm feeling, which one I use. But there's something beautiful about the cup also, because you can see a lot about the color of the blood that is coming out of you, how your body is, because I notice huge differences sometimes if my period is really late and it might be dark and be clumpy, and then some months it's really clear and red. So there's a lot of knowledge that you can also get from actually seeing the blood that's coming out.
Yeah. And it comes from the, it's not good from the like Ayurvedic sense, the apana vayu energy. It wants that downward energy. So maybe if you want to continue the downward energy, but you want to use a cup, then you can maybe change it more often if you feel like that's better. But like Loviisa said, you know, do what feels good for you.
I have to jump. Thank you so much. This was amazing. Oh, yay. Amazing. Thanks for being here.
Yeah.
Amazing. So maybe we can keep going.
Yeah,
and it's pretty much the end of it anyway. We can get to some deeper questions Q&A time. So yeah, just to finish up on this, using as natural products as possible. And because again, you are nature and your body thrives on nature. And so, yeah, when you balance your hormones by using or being as connected to your inner nature as possible, your inner cycles and using, yeah, just being as natural as possible, you balance your hormones. And when you balance your hormones, you're balancing your brain, your metabolism, your immune system, your gut microbiome, your stress response system, your sexual reproductive system, literally everything, your thoughts, your emotions, your everything that we've talked about, like everything that your hormones are like this umbrella that control everything else. And so when you get to balancing your hormones, you balance all other aspects of your life and you'll see like, wow, I feel so much more connected to myself because I'm going with the flow of my cycle. And so this relieves a lot of stress, anxiety, depression, bloating, cramping, hair loss, acne, and other hormonal imbalances. But again, using and seeing those hormonal imbalances or those symptoms as a sign to more self-love. So it's a beautiful thing and a process of growth and a journey of reconnecting with yourself. And so the more you connect with nature, the sun, the moon, the food you eat, practice mindfulness, awareness, and the more you balance your hormones, you feel better mentally, physically, emotionally, and energetically. So if you want to learn more, I do have a 13-page ebook that is, it's a little bit about what we learned today and a little bit more and different. And it's simplified into 13 pages. So you'll learn what is needed nutritionally, mentally, physically, and emotionally for each of the four phases of your cycle, as well as if you want to learn more from me privately, I have a 2-hour session that we can have together that you could just go to my website, balanceyourcycle.com, and book that. Or you can also join my upcoming 3-month online group program, and that starts next Tuesday. So if any of you want to join that, please write me a message on Instagram or go to my website again to apply. And yeah, it's basically 3 months where we go deeply into all of these topics and more. Like we go into intimacy, the connection to yourself, more into your fertility cycle and understanding really emotional tools that you can use and having a group of supportive women going through this journey with you, whether that's coming off hormonal birth control or you really need the accountability to go through these 3 months together and see the progress. And after 3 months, not have any more PMS or period pains, then yeah, send me a message. It starts on Tuesday. So yeah, thank you so much. Again, when you are balancing your hormones, you're not only supporting yourself, but everyone around you. And you understand, you have more empathy, more love for yourself. So you have more empathy and love for those around you. And if you want to connect with me, go to my website, balanceyourcycle.com. And on Instagram, I'm Pauline Giselle.
Yeah. Is there any, we're happy to answer any questions now that you might have. I know we already went through a couple. Are we really get pregnant on ovulation phase or any day of the month? I feel so risky and scared even though I'm not on my fertile window.
Yeah, so you can only get pregnant when you ovulate. And there have been some rare cases, and you might have heard this as well, that, oh, my friend got pregnant while she was bleeding. And again, it comes down to when did you ovulate? And so let's say you make love on day 4 of your cycle and you're still bleeding, but you ovulate early that month and you ovulate on day 9 of your cycle. So you're done bleeding, you make love while you're bleeding on day 4, and then you stop bleeding and you're like, yeah, I'm not fertile, but your cervix was open during menstruation. So then when you made love, the sperm came in and then it closes up. And then a few days later, you ovulate on day 9. And so since sperm can live inside of you for up to 5 days, there is the potential happening of you getting pregnant when you made love during your bleed. So this is why it's really important not only to track the first day of your cycle, the first day of your bleed, but also when you ovulate. And when you do track your cycle and start balancing your hormones so that you do have like consistent ovulation, and it's really important to ovulate. It is the vital sign that you are healthy when you ovulate. So tracking that, you can be like, oh, okay, I'm ovulating on day 13 every cycle. So now I can actually plan my fertility like pretty well according to that. And
yeah, I feel like really tracking like the temperature method has worked super well for me, because obviously it's something that I also felt super nervous about when I switched. But it has worked super well for me. I have the Aura ring and it syncs now with my natural cycles app. Mm-hmm. So it's super easy and I can just track it every month. But especially in the beginning, like if you're with a male partner, like just use a condom or anything to give you peace of mind for that time. Mm-hmm. And then once you get more, it will take like natural cycles, for example, it will take a couple of months or to get your data and understand how your cycle works, mm-hmm. but then it will be really consistent. But yeah, just do what feels good for you. But I feel like it needs to be something that you feel comfortable with. So there's many, many ways to do that without necessarily choosing to use hormonal birth control. Mm-hmm. There was another quick question. About do you go through these phases minus menstruation during pregnancy and menopause as well?
Great question. Mm-hmm. So when you get pregnant, your hormone cycle is different. You can still probably I haven't been pregnant yet, I hope to someday, but and in menopause as well, like even though, and even if you don't have a menstruation, let's say, or an ovulation and you're missing your period and things like that, you still have a cycle. You can tune into the moon cycle and see how, you know, from this workshop, what you've learned of like my hunger level, your hunger levels, your mindset and things like that, of like, okay, I feel on new moon that right now I'm it's about to be new moon in a few days. So maybe you think, okay, I feel like I'm about to get my period, but then you don't get your period, and you can move with that. So even if you're pregnant or in menopause, you can use the moon cycle as your cycle. And through pregnancy, what happens is that you make more progesterone, and progesterone is, yeah, the pregnancy hormone, and it makes your skin healthy, your hair. And so you'll notice pregnant women are having gorgeous hair and skin, and yeah, so that's the cycle. It's a different cycle for the pregnancy. It's a 9 month long cycle. And then in menopause, what happens, and even before menopause, you have perimenopause. So you can kind of see as life, like you're in emptiness here, you're born, and then you go, you're a child, and until you get your first period, you have like a daily hormone schedule. And then you get your first period and you're in a adolescent, and your hormones are like, woo, what's going on, like puberty. And then you have the reproductive age. So it takes about 5 years between, let's say, 13 and 18, where a teenager will feel like, and it's actually really normal for a teenager. This is very important because there's a lot of over prescribing of hormonal birth control from doctors, and it's like, for me, for example, I came in, I'm like, I have 2 week long periods. And the doctor didn't tell me that's normal. He told me, here, just take the pill. But if I knew that it's normal to have 2 week long periods during the teenage phase, while our hormones are trying to figure themselves out and balancing out, then I would have been like, oh, okay, no problem. Like, I'll just try to like learn about my cycle, you know? And, but then from the age of 18 up until you're 35-ish, you're in the reproductive age. And this reproductive age is what we learned about today.
and where you have the four phases of your cycle. And then you go from about 35 to when you don't have a period anymore. And it's different for everyone, menopause and perimenopause. Ask your mom or your grandma what age they had menopause at. So menopause is when you haven't had a period for a year. And perimenopause are the 5 to 10 years before menopause. And this is when you go through second puberty. This is when, so here was emptiness, and then here your fullness at the reproductive age. And then you're going back towards, towards the emptiness of, you're going through your second puberty, and then you go through menopause, and then we all die. And then maybe the life cycle starts all over again. And depending on what you believe in, of course, but you go through, you know, when you're a baby and when you're really old, you need someone to take care of you. And then you have the puberty age, and then you have the reproductive age. So even women who have had a hysterectomy where they've gotten their uterus removed, they still have a cycle too. Like, you can still connect with the moon, and you still have your ovaries potentially that are making the estrogen, progesterone, and making you feel the different emotions and thought patterns and energy. So yeah,
this question I thought also was pretty good.
I currently have the Mirena IUD and wanting to switch to natural birth control. However, I am an endometriosis sufferer and nervous about making the change. Do you have any advice and recommendations? Yes, amazing. So whatever hormonal imbalance you have, including endometriosis, including PCOS, you are able to treat this naturally. And I have helped many women get rid of endometriosis and PCOS naturally. It happens. It works. When you honor your natural cycle, then your body's like, thank you. Like, now I don't have any symptoms. So I've helped many women who were like you on hormonal birth control, because what happens is that in endometriosis, it's when you have an excess of estrogen. And so estrogen is what makes your endometrial lining grow inside of your uterus. The women with endometriosis, that endometrial tissue can grow in the outside of the uterus, and it then gets stuck to other organs, and it's really painful, especially during your menstruation. So what you want to do when you have endometriosis is, and you want to come off of hormonal birth control, you want to focus on foods that are like those phytoestrogens. And so you're detoxing and those excess estrogens of your own natural body, you're balancing your hormones out, and you're having a little bit more of the estrogen detox foods, which are foods high in DIM. It's a long scientific word, but yeah, DIM, it's that cruciferous vegetable family, like broccoli, kale, cauliflower, Brussels sprouts, cabbage, and phytoestrogens, those beans and seeds, food groups. So those will really help. And again, yeah, I've helped many women with endometriosis and PCOS by lowering their symptoms, lowering their and balancing their hormones so that they don't have any more symptoms. They don't have the extreme pain anymore during their bleed. So, and in PCOS, women with PCOS, it's really important to know it's really overdiagnosed as well. You cannot be diagnosed with PCOS with just an ultrasound. It doesn't mean that you have too many cysts on your ovaries. A lot of the times with an ultrasound, it takes a photo and it sees all of these follicles, and we all have follicles. That's what turns into the eggs. But when you have PCOS, there's four different types of PCOS, and they all need to have a high level of male hormones. They're called androgens. Otherwise, there's like a blood sugar, like an insulin resistance PCOS. There's a post-pill induced PCOS. And this is, again, just meaning that you have too many male hormones. So learning to move and eat and think and feel with your cycle, then you balance your hormones, and your body's like, ah, thank you for bringing back to my natural programming in a way. So yeah.
Then there was another question. My period cycle is long, up to 35 days, which I feel like is quite common, but I have minimal negative symptoms during
symptoms during month. Are each of the phases equally split along the cycle? I can tell when I'm ovulating and menstruation, but not sure how long the follicular phase is.
Great question. So when you have really long cycles, it means that you tend to have more estrogen or more hormones that your liver is needing to work through. Your liver is basically what is metabolizing all of your hormones. And so when you have more stress or more, like just more hormones that your body needs to go through, then it lengthens your cycle. So when you have a 35-day cycle, you can try to reduce it if that's your what you want to do. But if you feel good throughout your cycle, then, you know, great, obviously. And what was the other part of that question? Oh, you don't know when, really, how long your follicular and luteal phase is. So when you start your bleed, like day one of your period, and it's not the couple days of spotting before your period, but really like the full bleed day. And then however long that lasts, and maybe the last couple days will be lighter, but it's not really, you don't really need to know, or it's not as important to know how long your follicular or luteal phase is necessarily. What's most important is the first day of your period and when you ovulate. In the ovarian cycle, which means the egg maturation, the egg growth, and then the holding on to the egg, those are two phases. It's the follicular phase and the luteal phase. So technically, your follicular phase starts on day one of your period because your egg is already trying to produce or to create the new or grow the new egg. So your follicular phase, the moving into the, from bleeding into your follicular phase is, you can choose when it's not very important to know, let's say, but you can say, oh, I'm finishing bleeding and I'm going into my follicular phase. And you might not feel that high energy until a couple days after you bleed, you're done bleeding too. So it can take some time, but you'll feel more and more energy. And then ovulation, how you know you enter the luteal phase is that estrogen drop. Like you're like, woo, I'm ovulating, I feel amazing. And then the next morning you wake up, you feel more hungry, you want to clean your hands more often and organize your house. And you notice the mood drop. And yeah, then you're like, okay, I've entered the luteal phase. So you need to have at least 11 days of the luteal phase. So from ovulation until you bleed for it to be healthy, that to know that you're making enough progesterone. Progesterone, the only way to make progesterone is if you ovulate. And again, that progesterone is really beneficial for your sedating, for calming you down, but it's really good for your brain health, your bone growth, and like so many benefits to it health-wise. So this is why it's really empowering to know about your cycle so that you can make most of these healthy. Yeah, having an optimal fertility is optimal health. So
we asked, what is the reason of blood clots when menstruating?
So blood clots tend to mean that there's stagnation. And so there's not enough energy moving and flowing around. It can mean that you are, for example, even if your blood is on the darker side and you have blood clots, this means you're too cold. So you want to warm up your body with some more movements. It can also mean that, like, yeah, if you're not wearing socks before, this is in Chinese medicine, they say like you have to be warm, like you have to cover up your womb and wear socks before your period, and on your period, you know, have warmth, be warm. So that can create clots as well. And if you have little clots, like less than a couple centimeters or less than an inch, it's okay to have the occasional one. But if you have ones that are more than an inch or a couple centimeters, then that would signify there needs to be a change, or a change needs to happen. So, and it could be from the food you eat. And again, I'm really interested to hear as well, like once you do start implementing some of these changes according to your cycle, you'll see a reduction of those clots. But yeah, those clots tend to mean stagnation. So it can be emotional, mental, physical stagnation as well. And to help with that, to bring more circulation, again, is moving your body, but bringing
warming spices to your foods, like cinnamon is really good, especially if you haven't had a period for a long time. Cinnamon is really good to bring energy and blood circulation to your womb. But cinnamon I would avoid if you have really, really heavy periods. So if you have endometriosis, I wouldn't do cinnamon, for example.
Speaking of blood deficiency, there was a couple of questions about what to do if your hair is thinning or falling out.
Mm-hmm.
Also have questions about things you can do for hair loss.
Yeah, I could speak definitely from a personal experience. So when I came off hormonal birth control, and if any of you do decide to come off hormonal birth control, there will be some and can be some side effects for sure, but you don't have to go through them if you do follow your cycle. You try to make it as smooth of a transition as possible. And I lost like half my hair when I went through hormonal birth control, and I was on a journey to balancing my hormones once I found out about cycle awareness. And yeah, I gained all of my hair back within a year. So things you can do is live by your cycle, because so all of the things that I mentioned before, moving with your cycle, eating with your cycle, thinking, feeling, reducing stress, like those are the things that are going to help make you thrive. When you have balanced hormones, you are going to thrive in all aspects of your life. So that's your hair grows back, your you absorb more nutrients and you reduce stress, and that's going to help you absorb more nutrients and grow your hair. And so it's a whole lifestyle thing. It's not just one thing necessarily that you can do, but it's like taking a look at your whole life and reducing stress and nourishing your body with the certain nutrients for each phase, the workouts and things like that. That's what's going to bring your hair back. Some other things that I've tried is like rosemary oil helps bring circulation, like heat to your head. So if you can make like a rosemary tea and then put it in a spray bottle, and you can spray that in your hair. For a while, I was also using argan oil with rosemary oil, but just one drop of rosemary oil because it's very potent. And yeah, doing that at night before going to bed is really helpful as well. And yeah.
Then there's a couple questions also that are coming a few times about the plan B. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'd love to hear about the plan B question. I rely on it too often. This is terrible for my body and hormones, I know, but I don't want to take the risk of falling pregnant again. I feel constantly anxious about falling pregnant, but also want to avoid taking it because of how much reproductive system has suffered over the last 10 years from various things and the effect it will have on me and my family again once I've taken it.
Yeah, so the wisdom of the cycle is empowerment. Like when you know more, when you learn about yourself more, you can take better care of yourself. And so understanding your cycle and reconnecting with yourself, then when knowledge is power. When you know yourself, then you're like, yes, I ovulate on day 14. So I'm like, I know that I can prepare for that. I can use a condom. I can notice the physical changes in my cycle, and I can notice the emotional changes. Oh, I can feel that I'm approaching ovulation right now. I can feel my libido, my sex drive is coming. So I'm going to wear a condom. And by knowing yourself, knowing the symptoms, knowing the signs that your body is telling you, like prepare for pregnancy, then you can either plan for it or prevent it. And having that confidence in knowing your body better than anyone else is the most empowering thing. And so you will, I fully trust in you that you, yeah, already will know so much more about your body and what signs your body is telling you, so that you can make the best decision for yourself.
And maybe while you are ovulating and there's the window of possibly getting pregnant, there's other forms of pleasure that you can explore with your partner. So it doesn't necessarily have to be penetration. If you have a male partner, it can be something completely different. So exploring that also during that time can be really exciting. Mm-hmm. But as long as you feel safe with the person
yeah,
that you are with.
but that could be something. But I feel like it can't be taken for granted that women or like the women and the choice that we have to have sex or not, or to maybe keep a baby, or like it's such a big question, so it needs to be respected by the partner that we're with as well.
Mm-hmm.
So definitely know that power that you have in yourself to make the decision, so you don't have to fall back on the plan B if that's mm-hmm. not what you're wanting.
Yeah, and communicate with your partner too. Mm. Like, have your partner learn about your cycle as well. Mm-hmm. And if that brings so much more awareness and love into the relationship, so yeah, not having it stay as a taboo to talk about the cycle and when you might be ovulating or bleeding. And
yeah. And there's a beauty also about explaining this to your partner, because then they know how to support you and show up for you, and you know how to ask for things, because we can't also expect our partners to know what we need, so we need to always communicate it. So when we know how our system works, then we can explain this and communicate it to our partner, and then they can show up to us the way that we feel loved and supported.
Totally.
So that's super important.
Yeah.
Then there was another one. My cycle changes between 24 and 28 days. Few months it's shorter, and then others it's longer. Do you think it's diet, seasonal, outward energy?
Yeah, I mean, gosh, with that little of information, I can't tell you. But again, the top two main things that are going to balance your hormones or bring your hormones out of balance are stress and nutrition. So maybe some months you're not feeding yourself as healthy as you did the last months when you had 28-day cycles, or you maybe traveled, you didn't sleep well, you partied, and alcohol has a big effect. Caffeine has a big effect. So I really want to talk about caffeine really quick. Caffeine is, especially if you have coffee on an empty stomach, it's better to have it after having a meal. But if you can get rid of caffeine altogether, that'll be the best, because caffeine is basically a drink that puts you into the fight or flight mode instantly. It makes you go to the bathroom because you can't rest and digest, and then it makes you super focused. So it puts you in this like survival mode. I need to focus and work, basically. You can get natural energy by not getting caffeine, and you can again work with your cycle and understand, oh, my brain is focusing on the future right now, I'll plan some projects, and then on the other, in the luteal phase, you'll focus on details. And so caffeine is going to affect your cycle a lot and your sleep patterns and things like that. So again, yeah, stress and nutrition are going to maybe move your cycle around a bit.
Mm-hmm. Love to know how we can do if menstruation delayed for a long time, like over 6 months.
Yeah, so if you haven't had your period in a while, and I would love for you to tell me which phase of the cycle do you feel you resonate with more. When we were going through this workshop and you were like, oh, like I'm having those feelings and I'm thinking like that, and so those are the questions I ask. How hungry are you when you wake up? And in the day, do you feel you have that like outward energy and you want to go do stuff? Or do you feel more introverted and thinking of the past? And then when you find which phase you resonate with more, for example, right now it's going to be new moon in a couple of days.
Mm.
So if you feel like, let's say you have more of that outward energy and you have that energy where you're maybe about to ovulate soon, then take the moon. Oh, it's new moon. So then you can start eating and moving with as if you are in that phase of your cycle. And you use the moon as your guide. I've gotten a few women's cycles back doing this, just being like, okay, how do you feel most like in which phase of your cycle, and using the moon as the guide. And then they start living by that phase. And then boom, 1 month later, like I had a student in my program who didn't have her period for a year and a half. And then within the first month of the cycle, she got her period back just by doing by living with her cycle on where she feels she felt most with.
I also saw someone ask the question about the breakfast thing, if should they just force themselves to eat in the morning within that first hour if they're not hungry. I feel like I would have something. It doesn't have to be like a massive meal, but I would probably have something to eat. And then over time, you teach your body what the actual, like, to get back into balance. Because also, if you're not hungry in the morning, I'd say that is also a sign of some sort of imbalance. So maybe start small, like start with tiny steps, and then go from there, because breakfast is super, super important.
Yeah. And when you're not hungry in the morning, your body start, you have a natural spike in cortisol and stress. And when you're stressed, you're not hungry. Or maybe you can be like, oh, I'm going to stress eat, but it's more of like a survival kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
But so you have, when you do eat, then you're already lowering your, like, your stress levels down. And so it's a good thing to start with, food.
Mm-hmm.
So just eat something small. And then also just know where you are in your cycle. If you're about to ovulate, you naturally feel less hungry. But if you are in the luteal phase, like, make, have a nice breakfast, like one with consistency, so that you are balancing your blood sugar levels. And it, whenever you do feel like a little anxious or irritable in your luteal phase, like, just eat. Your body will be like, okay.
Yeah. Because in our physiology, it's actually really important that we get food, because it does bring the stress levels down, because that's how we used to operate from back in the day. Like, we needed to find food,
mm-hmm.
and that was the stress. Now we don't have that stress anymore, because we live in this world that is so abundant in so many ways in that regard. But we need to make sure that we don't forget that. And someone asked, in our masculine energy dominated world, I find it so stressful to let myself be slow, not working out hard, and overall less productive for 2 weeks, every month. Thoughts or advice?
Yeah, a lot of us go through this, but it's tuning in. It's allowing yourself to tap into your feminine energy. And yes, we have a lot of that external pressure to constantly be productive and to work out harder and things like that, but just do what is best for you. And, you know, the only person you can make happy is yourself. You can't change other people around you, only yourself, really. And yeah, when you honor your cycle and when you honor yourself, you're gonna feel so much better. And yeah, it's not the people, the society, that pressure that you get from the external world that is going to, it's, are you trying to search gratification from the outside, or can you find that gratification and that love, that happiness from within?
And find a community that feels aligned to you also. I feel like that sort of support from other people who, even like other like women or sisters or whoever that person might be for you who resonates with that, even just having like a support and a network to talk about it can be immensely helpful.
Yeah, women's circles, and just again, yeah, surrounding yourself with people who support you, because you want to surround yourself with people who love you and support you.
So again,
like, all forms of stress, it can be emotional, physical, and just your surroundings. Is it an environmental stress? And you know, who are you surrounding yourself with? We support you.
Yes. That's why we also find these workshops really awesome, and love that everyone's been asking so many questions. We feel really connected. I feel super happy how today has gone. We'll just answer a couple more and then we'll finish. There's a lot of people wondering about OmCycle Yoga and where they can find it.
Yeah, different styles for the time of cycle. Yeah, so if you can connect with me on my Instagram, Pauline Giselle, or on balanceyourcycle.com. I do have a few videos, like
I have seven, so there are seven chakras, seven main hormone glands, and with each phase of the cycle, yeah, if you want, you can go back to that page. I have these videos available on, they're not actually on my website right now, but if you send me a message on Instagram, I can share them with you. And yeah, so if you want to do that, then just send me a message. And I have some shorter videos, some like 20 to 40 minute long videos. And then I have some that are an hour and a half as well, if you want a full practice. So yeah, there's about 14 to 20 videos of OmCycle Yoga. If any of you are interested, just reach out to me and we can make that happen.
And last question, is there an ideal sleep schedule?
Is there an ideal sleep schedule? Yes. So actually in your follicular phase up until ovulation, you don't need as much sleep. Whereas in the luteal phase, you need more sleep. So you'll notice that maybe in the follicular to ovulation, you have 6 hours or 7.5 hours of sleep. Your sleep cycle is 90 minutes long. So you fall asleep and you're in your light sleep, and then 45 minutes later, you're in your deep sleep. And then 45 minutes after that, you're in your light sleep again. So it's a cycle of 90 minutes. And so you'll notice that if you don't set an alarm, that you have slept for a multiplication of 90 minutes. Mm-hmm. Like let's say it's 6 hours, 7.5 hours, or 9 hours. Those are all divisible by 90 minutes. So it's really important if you do set an alarm to set an alarm after or when you would be in your light sleep. Mm-hmm. So in your follicular phase, you can have 6 or 7.5 hours. And then in your luteal phase, you do need more. So at least 7.5 or 9 hours. And same with your menstruation to have more sleep as well. It's the luteal and menstrual phases are times to slow down and sleep more and relax.
Completely. There were some really beautiful messages here. No questions, just huge gratitude and appreciation to the team behind this workshop and both of you for sharing your wisdom from the deepest of my heart. I know I'll carry the knowledge for life. And I'll solidify and keep me closer to my body than ever. Yay. Thank you so much. That is just the purpose of today, was just to see if there was anyone in the community that was interested in joining the workshop. And so grateful for you all for joining in. It's been really beautiful. Beautiful Saturday morning for us here in Bali.
So empowering for sure.
Amazing.
Thank you so much, everyone.
Yes,
thank you for being here.
Yeah. And if there was anyone from the workshop that wanted to go to Indigo, Luna, so for 48 hours, we have a code hormones for 10% off. If there is anything that you've been eyeing off, just as a little extra offering, but see what resonates with you. And just super, super grateful for you all for being here today.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Amazing. Thank you, everyone. Have a beautiful weekend. Bye.